He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we solved the time-independent Schrödinger equation for a quantum particle in an infinite square well, also known as the problem of the particle in a box. As we learned, the solution to this problem takes the form of a set of eigenfunctions, represented by psi sub n, and their corresponding energies, E sub n, which both depend on the length of the well, represented by A, and where K sub n is equal to n pi over A, where n is the set of positive integers. These expressions should look familiar, so if they aren't, make sure to watch Particle in a Box Part 1 first and get yourself up to speed. Now what we are going to do is to try to understand these results on a deeper level. A good way to start is to analyze the steps we took to solve the equation. First, recall that we imposed the condition that the wave function must be continuous over its domain of existence. This was because the wave function must equal zero where the potential is infinity, including the boundaries of the well, and the wave function must have some non-zero value where the potential is zero, or within the well. And second, we imposed the condition that the wave function must be normalized. This is because normalization ensures that the probability of finding a particle within the boundaries is not greater than 1. In this way, a wave function that is not normalized can't represent physical reality. Now, there is another property of wave functions that we have discussed, but that we haven't mentioned yet in this context. We must recall that solutions to the Schrödinger equation, which correspond to different eigenvectors, are orthogonal. So, referring back to our solution set, each value of n defines a solution to the equation given by a different wave function, psi, and corresponding with a different eigenenergy. Each wave function in the solution set is linearly independent with respect to the others, and as we recall, this can be expressed mathematically as follows, with the inner product of psi sub n and psi sub m being equal to the Kronecker delta, which equals 1 whenever n equals m, and equals 0 whenever n and m are not equal. Here, the subscripts are simply referring to different wave functions, so if n equals 1 and m equals 2, the inner product of psi 1 and psi 2 equals delta 1 comma 2, which equals 0, since these are two different wave functions from the solution set and are thus orthogonal, so their inner product must be 0. But if n and m both equal 2, then the inner product of psi 2 with itself will equal delta 2 comma 2, which equals 1, since the inner product of any wave function with itself must be 1. Let's go ahead and make sure that the wave functions in our solution set satisfy this condition. Recalling the definition of the inner product and the boundaries of our system, this must equal the integral from 0 to a of psi sub n star of x times psi sub m of x dx, which again equals the Kronecker delta. As we already know, this term equals 0 when n and m are not equal, and it equals 1 when n and m are equal. We solved this integral for the case where n equals m when we normalized the wave function in the previous tutorial, and saw that it did indeed equal 1. Now we must solve for the case where n and m are not equal, meaning that we are looking at two different wave functions from the solution set. So let's plug in our expression for psi so that we can find out if any two arbitrary wave functions are indeed orthogonal. Given that there are no imaginary terms here, psi star is the same as psi, so we can just take the integral of psi sub n times psi sub m, which will only be different in that one has n in the parenthetical and the other has m. Each has a root 2 over a term, so those can be pulled out of the integral as constants, where they multiply to give 2 over a. And what we have left is the product of two sine terms, which can't be combined because the parentheticals are different. Now, as with many other instances in which we are integrating trigonometric functions, there is a particular trigonometric identity that will be useful. In this case, we need to use the identity which says that 2 sine theta sine phi equals cosine theta minus phi minus cosine theta plus phi. This is useful because it splits up a product of trigonometric functions into a difference, which makes it easier to integrate. So if we consider theta to be n pi over a times x, and phi to be m pi over a times x, we can make this substitution. First, since we don't have a 2 multiplying the product of signs, we will actually get 1 half of this result, so we can compensate by pulling 1 half out of the integral, thereby reducing 2 over a to 1 over a. Then, inside the integral, we get the cosine of n pi over a times x minus m pi over a times x minus the cosine of n pi over a times x plus m pi over a times x. We can get these parentheticals to each become one term simply by factoring out the n's and m's. So for the first one, we can factor out n minus m, and for the second one, we can factor out n plus m. And now, believe it or not, we have something simple that is ready to integrate, because we just have cosine terms with some constant times x. This means that in finding the antiderivative, we will get sine terms with the same parenthetical, but each will be divided by its respective constant, so that if we were to differentiate, the constant coming out front by the chain rule would get canceled out. So that leaves us with the constant 1 over a from earlier, times this quantity, a over n minus m times pi, sine n minus m times pi over a times x, minus a over n plus m times pi, sine n plus m times pi over a times x. Now it's time to plug in our limits of integration in place of x and evaluate. If we plug in a, we can see that it will cancel out with the other a in each term, which leaves us with the sine of some multiple of pi. The sine of any multiple of pi is 0, so plugging in a gives us 0 for the whole expression. Likewise, plugging in 0 means taking the sine of 0, which is 0, so again, the whole expression is 0. So altogether, no matter what values are to be used for n and m, we get 0 minus 0, which is 0. In this way, we have proven that any two wave functions from the solution set must be orthogonal. Now, for the second realization, we turn from the wave functions, or eigenfunctions, over to the eigenenergies. This expression contains n as well, and the smallest value n can take is 1. This represents the lowest energy, or ground state energy, for the particle in the box. This gives us a markedly quantum result. The quantum particle cannot possess zero energy. With a classical system, we could expect a value of zero for kinetic energy. If a tennis ball was sitting still at the bottom of the well, we would regard this as having zero kinetic energy. But the quantum particle is not like this. It is delocalized, sitting everywhere it is allowed to be all at once and at all times. There is actually another way we can prove to ourselves that n can't be zero. Let's return to our generalized expression for psi. If n equals zero, then k sub n equals zero, and we are taking the sine of zero, which is zero. That means psi sub zero equals zero, and the corresponding probability density function would equal zero everywhere inside the well, and the particle therefore does not exist. So in order for the particle to exist at all, it can never possess zero energy. This is a fascinating aspect of quantum mechanics that is in stark contrast with classical mechanics, and it is important to internalize this strange fact as thoroughly as possible, even if it seems to defy common sense. Now let's tackle some slightly more nuanced points. We are first going to calculate the expectation value for momentum, and then the expectation value for kinetic energy. So let's start out by calculating the expectation value for the momentum operator for the first solution, psi 1. As we recall, this is written by sandwiching the momentum operator in brackets between the ket of psi and bra of psi, which equals the integral from 0 to a of root 2 over a sine k1x times negative I h bar d dx root 2 over a sine k1x dx. Let's pull out the constants. Root 2 over a and root 2 over a both come out and multiply to give 2 over a. And we can pull out negative I times h bar as well. Left inside is sine k1x times the partial derivative with respect to x of sine k1x dx. The derivative of sine k1x with respect to x is k1 cosine k1x, so let's make that change and pull k1 out to be with the other constants. Now it's time to use another one of our fancy trigonometric identities. It is the case that sine 2 theta equals 2 sine theta cosine theta. Therefore, sine theta cosine theta equals sine 2 theta over 2. This means that we can take sine k1x cosine k1x and express it as sine 2 k1x over 2. Allowing this 2 to cancel out the 2 out here, that leaves us with this, and this is no problem to integrate. The antiderivative of this sine term will be negative cosine, and then we must divide by 2k1 due to the chain rule that would occur when differentiating. We can put the negative sign out front, and these k1 terms will cancel out, leaving us with 1 over 2a times ih bar times cosine 2k1x. Now we can evaluate this first at a, and then subtract from that the evaluation at 0. This entails just replacing x with a, and then 0. Now recall that the k term equals n pi over a, and for k1, n will be 1, so k1 equals pi over a. For the second term, it doesn't matter because it's being multiplied by 0, so that's just cosine of 0. But for the first term, the a's cancel and we get cosine of 2 pi. Cosine of 2 pi is 1, and cosine of 0 is also 1. 1 minus 1 is 0, which means our answer here is 0. So what we have determined here is that the expectation value of the momentum of the particle in a box is always zero. This may seem a bit strange, and we will contextualize this in a moment, but first let's perform this same operation for kinetic energy. So we're going to do what we just did, but with the kinetic energy operator. As we recall, this is represented by T, and equal to negative h bar squared over 2m times the second partial derivative with respect to x. So to get the expectation value, this time we will have to evaluate this integral. We can pull the constants out of the integral, so that's negative h bar squared over 2m, as well as both of the root 2 over a terms. So the 2's cancel, leaving us with negative h bar squared over am. And inside the integral, we are left with sine k1x times the second derivative with respect to x of sine k1x dx. To continue, we need to evaluate this second derivative, so let's do this separately. The first derivative is k1 cosine k1x, so the second derivative is negative k1 squared sine k1x. Let's pull negative k1 squared out of the integral, so the negative signs cancel and we can put h bar k1 quantity squared in the numerator, since both of these terms are being squared. We have identical sine terms left in the integral, so we need to integrate sine squared k1x dx. Now, we just so happen to have solved this precise integral in the previous tutorial using yet another trigonometric identity, so refresh your memory there if you need to. Otherwise, we will just skip to the solution here. We end up with our constants from earlier times a over 2 minus sine of 2k1a over 4k1. Recalling that k equals n pi over a, we can plug that in everywhere we see k1. That gives us h bar n pi over a quantity squared over am times a over 2 minus sine of 2n pi over 4n pi over a. Conveniently, the sine of any multiple of pi is 0, so this whole sine term will always be 0, and we can get rid of it. Let's simplify by bringing the a squared down to the denominator where it belongs, to combine with the other a to get cubed. And then we can multiply this by the a over 2 term. This will cancel out one of the a's in the denominator and put a 2 down there as well. So we end up with h bar n pi quantity squared over 2m a squared. This expression is the expectation value for the kinetic energy operator. The most important thing to notice here is that n is squared, which means that kinetic energy increases quadratically with n. These results should initially be puzzling. We saw that the expectation value for momentum is zero, but we also just found that the expectation value for kinetic energy is not zero. How is this possible? The easiest way to understand this is to do some mathematical trickery. Let's recall the general form of the relevant eigenfunctions. Now, what we are going to do is use something called the Euler equation. This tells us that sine theta equals the complex exponential of I times theta minus its complex conjugate, divided by 2i. Let's use this in our eigenfunctions, treating k sub n x as theta, and plugging that in where we previously used theta. Now recall from a previous tutorial about wave functions that e to the I k1x is a rough representation of a wave traveling to the left, and e to the negative I k1x is a representation of a wave traveling to the right. So let's just split up this term into two individual terms and set up the following definitions for psi left and psi right. This means that the parenthetical can be written simply as psi left minus psi right. This formula tells us that the wave function psi sub n is a superposition of a wave traveling to the left and a wave traveling to the right with equal probability. This means that this particle is always traveling in both directions at the same time. So in this way, the particle doesn't really go anywhere, which is why its momentum is zero, but the particle is still technically moving, so its kinetic energy is not zero. And the last realization we will highlight is that there is a clear pattern emerging between the odd and even solutions, with odd solutions being those where n equals an odd number, and even solutions being those where n equals an even number. The odd solutions are symmetric about x equals a over 2, meaning that the left and right halves are mirror images. And the even solutions are anti-symmetric about this line, meaning that the halves are vertically flipped, such as the case with n equals 2, with one peak going up and the other going down. And with that, we have solved our first quantum problem, the problem of the particle in a box, and sufficiently analyzed its solution. So at this point, we should have a reasonable grasp of what eigenfunctions and eigenenergies are. They represent the states that a quantum particle can live in under a set of boundary conditions. Specifically, the eigenfunctions tell us the shape of the probability density function for each of the eigenenergies that satisfy the Schrödinger equation and the boundary conditions. The square well we have been playing in was a great place to get our feet wet because it challenges our intuitions for how particles behave in the quantum world. Even though a particle in an infinite well seems like a hopelessly abstract blackboard example, the techniques we used to solve the Schrödinger equation will always be the same, and the mathematical properties of the solutions are universal, regardless of the difficulty of the problem. As we move forward, we will continue to increase the complexity of the problems we tackle, thereby eliciting mathematical models that get us ever closer to elucidating this quantum realm of photons and electrons.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.